I'm Tim Treuer. I'm a postdoc working with Arna Bombleys in civil and environmental engineering, and also Taylor here at the Gund. I'm going to begin with a quick story, but before that, I just want to emphasize the question mark in my title. I'm going to be exploring an idea, an ecological kintsugi, that kind of needs stress testing. And so I hope we have a lively Q&A at the end. And with that, spare time. So after graduating from college, I traveled down to Southeast Asia, and I spent the better part of a year and a half in Kalimantan Barat on the Indonesian side of the island of Borneo. And I came down to work on a reforestation project in Gunung Palung National Park. It's home for like a double digit percentage of the world's remaining wild orangutans. And down there, there's an NGO that's working to turn back the tide against illegal logging and restore critically endangered lowland mixed dipterocarp forest. The project followed a pretty traditional model of forest restoration. We raised seedlings in a nursery, planted them at a density of like about 4,000 per hectare. And it was a really massive operation. There were dozens of paid laborers, even more volunteers. I lived out at the site for weeks at a time, no running water, electricity. I was plotting out this complex suite of experimental treatments. And we were trying to zero in on these optimal methods for restoring this ecological system. And it was a pretty tall order. The site that we were working on was covered in this invasive vegetation that grew, at times it was more than 2 meters tall. It grew so thick, I remember I could stick my arms out and fall forward into it, and it would hold me up before I hit the ground. And we were trying in one fell swoop to turn this really degraded ecosystem back into the most biodiverse place on Earth. It was really exhausting work. And, there were a lot of other challenges along the way. But, it felt worth it. I'm going to assume that this audience knows just how important tropical forests are for protecting biodiversity and delivering ecosystem services. So I'll just say it felt really amazing to have helped create habitat for just an incredible array of organisms while also having a positive impact on the local community. But at the same time, something about the project kind of troubled me a bit. Over the 2 years, the two planting seasons that I worked with them, we through blood, sweat, and tears, managed to replant about 16 hectares of forest at a cost of about $4,000 per hectare. And, in one sense, that seems like a small price to pay. It was like, 32 soccer pitches or something like that. But at the same time, it's, that area was less than what was being lost annually in Gunung Palung to illegal logging. With that price tag, it was this open question of, can this really scale up to meet the challenge? And if you think about scaling up to a global level, we're talking, tens of billions of dollars a year to reforest an area that's commensurate with the amount of forest that we're losing annually. And it's not clear where that funding would come from and who would sort of put that together, that effort. And then more immediately, I was wondering, if we'd spread our effort a little bit farther through less, expensive restoration methods, could we have done more? And then after I returned to the US to start my PhD, tragedy struck. I woke up one day to this email. A fire at the site that we had worked out had wiped out 97% of the area that we had worked so hard to restore. It was a real gut punch, and it was also an exclamation point on those misgivings that I had that maybe this intensive model for tropical forest restoration could be improved upon. So thinking about ecological restoration more broadly, I think this I was able to sort of put kind of more words and ideas to this idea, to the needs that ecological restoration could be made to address in a better way. And so if we think about ecological restoration, generally we imagine taking this degraded system that's in state B, and we want to move it back and recreate this pristine original system, state A. And if you think about it from sort of an energetic standpoint, we often talk about the degraded system as being this, you know, stable system, and the pristine state as being, you know, this climax system. And we've got to put in the effort to roll, you know, push this ball up the hill before it finally settles down into the pristine state that it's meant to be, that it was once upon a time. But that takes effort to overcome barriers to recovery, like the fires that we encountered, but also, you know, the invasive vegetation, maybe degraded soils. You can think of a whole list of factors depending on the habitat that you're talking about. But where this model, I think, kind of falls short and pushes us to not be efficient with our resources and kind of create problems with scaling up restoration, is that maybe the model's broken in a couple of ways. So in the first case, what I think that I saw in Kalimantan Barat is that the system didn't so much look like this as like this. There were these really intense barriers that we had to overcome initially, these fires, the invasive vegetation. But once we were past those, the forest should recover pretty well on its own. And yet we were putting all this effort, we were planting literally hundreds of different species of seedlings to try and just go from state B all the way back to state A in one fell swoop. And maybe what we should have been doing is focusing entirely on trying to get to this intermediate state C that on its own will progress to the pristine state. We should have been putting more effort into not planting hundreds of species, but maybe planting fewer, faster growing species that could grow quickly and shade out the grasses and the invasive ferns that that were serving as the fuel for the fire. That should have been our focus. And then allowing nature to do the heavy lifting of bringing in the full suite of species that we're missing. The other way that I think the model might be kind of broken is that maybe this pristine state, the original pristine state that we want to restore to, maybe that's not actually stable anymore. So in some cases with issues like climate change, maybe an entire region that's been degraded is no longer climatologically able to support rainforest or tropical forest anymore. Maybe it's become a better fit for a tropical savanna. And the idea of restoration, of coming back to this baseline state, is not super a super good fit for that scenario. And then also maybe that original pristine state is unstable because there are too many unaddressed needs by a community, the surrounding community that's impoverished. And maybe a stable state could be something like an agroforest that addresses the needs of the local community, provides them income, pulls them out of poverty, in some cases extreme poverty, but also still delivers a lot of the ecosystem services that we're looking for out of that original ecosystem. It stores carbon. It stabilizes soils, it provides clean water to local communities, all while also meeting a lot of the missing local human needs. And neither of those are really captured in the idea of ecological restoration. And so something that I've been thinking about for a long time is, you know, is there a better model? Is there ways that we could tweak the idea of ecological restoration or expand it? And that's really what I set out to do in my PhD work, which was looking at how we can scale up ecological restoration. I didn't really have any sort of framework or a term for it as I was doing my PhD until literally like a week before I submitted the final draft of my dissertation. This term ecological kintsugi did not appear in the first draft that I submitted to my committee. And I only really came across the idea while pursuing a AAAS Mass Media Fellowship the last summer of my PhD work. And so Kintsugi is, it's this Japanese art form, and it's very philosophically infused. And the art form involves taking broken pottery and using a lacquer that contains powdered gold or other precious metals to glue back together these broken shards to recreate a functional object again, a functional piece of ceramics. And it draws from this tradition in Japanese art called wabi-sabi that's itself drawn from rooted in Buddhist philosophy. The point of Kintsugi isn't to recreate this original lost object with as much fidelity as possible. They're not trying to hide these seams. They're not trying to rethrow a pot that's as close to identical as the original. But rather, it's about making it whole again while accepting and even celebrating the imperfections. And so I'm not going to go into this anymore because I'm not an expert in Buddhism, Japanese aesthetics, or aesthetics, or really any kind of art at all. But when I first heard about this idea of Kintsugi, it struck me that this is the metaphor. This is what I want to see happen. This is what I want to see become a new paradigm within conservation biology. And I immediately retconned my whole dissertation and said, this is what I've been working, this is the term that I've been looking for. This is what ties together my whole dissertation. And specifically, I think there's four really useful principles we could draw from this idea of Kintsugi if we're talking about creating this paradigm of ecological Kintsugi that's somewhat distinct, at least from ecological restoration. And I'm going to go through these with some examples drawn from my dissertation work and hopefully a little bit from my ongoing work that I referenced. But mostly I just want to try and leave time to discuss this idea with you all. So the first lesson I think is that we can draw is that it's really important to work with the fragments. And that might sound silly, but it's something that's so often ignored in a lot of cases of ecological restorations. We don't sufficiently leverage the pieces that we still have. And the fragments, they can be literal. Forest fragments, for example, little remnant patches of coral reefs. But, in size, they can be as small as I hope to show you, as small as an individual tree can be a fragment that's really important for the outcome of a process of ecological restoration, ecological Kintsugi. But these fragments can also be metaphorical, seed dispersers that are still hanging around in a degraded ecosystem. Maybe there's even still a seed bank present in the soil. Maybe there's just some bushy regrowth of non-native species, but they're still able to help suppress fires. I think those can all be fragments as well. So the example I want to give about this comes from a very special ecosystem in Costa Rica. It's a type of tropical forest called tropical dry forest, and they're characterized by a long pronounced dry season. So these trees that you're seeing in this image are not dead, they're just they're deciduous. They drop their leaves during the long dry season. And they're a bit less well known, at least to general audiences, the rainforest counterparts, but they're actually, at least once upon a time, were even greater in extent than tropical rainforests. But they're now much more heavily converted to other land uses than rainforests. And in the Mesoamerican biodiversity hotspot, that's particularly true. Like 3/4 of the original dry forest extent from this hotspot have been lost. The green on this map shows you where dry forest still exists in this area. The black shows you where it once was. And this little red arrow shows you the site where I did most of my dissertation research in Costa Rica. So much of what's left of dry forest, at least by the 70s and 80s in Mesoamerica, looked like this from the air. You see a few fragments of intact forest, often little stream or river buffers, a few patches of remnant forest here and there. And they were nestled within the sea of power ranches. On the ground, it looked like this. It's not great habitat for most of these endemic species that, that were living once upon a time in the intact dry forest. And in the 70s and 80s, it really looked like almost all of the dry forest in Mesoamerica might completely disappear unless something pretty incredible happened. And fortunately, something did start to turn around. There's really groundbreaking conservation project that was taking shape through the formation of this park in Costa Rica called the Área de Conservación Guanacaste. And there were a ton of people involved in creating this park. Among them, the person who's often cited as the father of the Costa Rican park system, Alvaro Ugalde. Literally thousands of Guanacastecos and Guanacastecas. But then also a couple of scientists that I want to highlight, Winnie Hawlox and Dan Jansen. And I'm going to highlight them because they're going to play a pretty central role through the rest of this talk. This is them pictured with their Mexican dwarf hairy porcupine, Espinita. They transitioned from very incredibly successful, influential careers in the field of tropical ecology to working almost full-time as conservationists sometime in the mid-80s. And they led the charge on raising funds that were used to purchase huge tracts of land, these heavily degraded cattle ranches back in the 80s and 90s, that were then used to reconnect two small national parks, two fragments of relatively intact ecosystem. They spent most, it's kind of a huge gamble. They spent almost all their money on buying up this land. And what was left over was mostly used to address the risk of fire. So they had a very efficient, very well-trained team of folks that put out fires that were raging through the park and destroying the few fragments of dry forest that were remaining. That didn't leave a lot of money for planting trees in the way that we kind of think of a typical forest reforestation project. And amazingly, that gamble paid off really, really well. A lot of this area that used to be cattle ranches in the 80s, just seas of grass with a few trees here and there, now looks like this, where it's mostly closed canopy tropical dry forest, well on its way to becoming mature. But that rosy picture kind of obscures some of the finer grain heterogeneity. So if you look carefully, you'll see areas like these two pictures that I took just less than a dozen kilometers apart. It's an area that was very similar in rainfall, topography, similar fire histories. And they've been recovering for a similar amount of time, yet one looks like a tropical dry forest, and the other still kind of looks like a cattle pasture. And so if we want to understand the value of fragments for ecological restoration or ecological kintsugi, you have to understand why, what was going on between these two pictures. And so for my project, I said about looking at a few of those factors, and I'm just going to quickly go through them. I don't know if fire history was maybe an explanation. Perhaps it was landscape composition, how close you are to the old growth forest, these fragments, the sources of seeds, the literal seeds of recovery. But also something that had been hypothesized to be really important were these individual trees growing in these cattle pastures. They're called nuclear trees because they're thought to nucleate forest recovery by drawing in seed dispersing birds and bats and other creatures. And so there's a lot of ways that you can measure the recovery of the forest. You can look at the structure, you can look at the species composition, you can look at the trees, you can look at saplings. And I tried to do all of these things. And I'm not going to go into a ton of details here, but basically we tried to look at these explanatory variables and look at how they affected the forest recovery. I'm going to use these aerial images to find where these nuclear trees were in the 80s, and I geo-reference these images to go back on the ground and find them in this regenerating forest. So this is this is what some of these trees look like on the ground. It's very obvious when you find one of them in the recovering forest. I set up some vegetative plots both nearby these nuclear trees, like immediately adjacent to them, and also in sort of the open bare cattle pasture. I ended up tagging, measuring, recording, identifying more than a thousand trees and 1,000 saplings. And then we'll go into the statistical approaches I use, but I'll just say that we came up with a system to try and identify which of these factors were most important for each of these individual outcome variables. So when we looked at the above ground biomass, we found that the best explanation for this variation that we're seeing in the amount of biomass that was growing in the regenerating forest. Really all you had to know was what was going on with the fires, how long it had been since the most recent fire. And then when we looked at the species richness, we found that fire again was a very important thing to look at. It's also important for both measures of saplings, both sapling stem density and also sapling richness. But we also found for species richness that being next to one of these nuclear trees was really important. We found on average about double the number of tree species in plots that were immediately adjacent to one of these nuclear trees compared to these plots that were not. And for sake of time, I'm not going to go into this, but you know, this is a really fine scale pattern. You can actually see when you're just a few meters from one of these nuclear trees, there's a much higher probability of being a tree that's animal dispersed. Whereas by the time you get like 50 meters away from them, you have a very, very low odds of being an animal dispersed tree. You're much more likely to be a wind dispersed species. And that's really important because like 80% of the native flora from these tropical dry forests are animal dispersed species. So you're missing a huge swath of the diversity when you don't have one of these nuclear trees nearby. And then for saplings, we found that the number of saplings was best explained by time since most recent fire, as well as the distance that you are from old growth forest. And then the sapling species richness, again, this nuclear tree factor popped up. When you're next to a nuclear tree, these violin plots on the road are showing is when you're next to a nuclear tree, there's a greater diversity of saplings. And this was amazing that even, you know, 20 years after the system had been regenerating, it still matters for the diversity of the saplings on the, you know, growing up underneath in a closed canopy. It still matters if you're next to one of these nuclear trees or not. So it's a pretty long lasting legacy that these trees have on the trajectory of forest recovery. And yeah, I'll just skip through this. We also looked at animals too and found, you know, this that these fragments that had been fragments for decades still were able to reseed this regenerating forest with an incredible diversity of tropical dry forest species like the jaguar. And a lot of their interactions were still being preserved. They seem to be reproducing just fine as this. This is actually a juvenile writing on her mom, I think. Lots of inquisitive animals out there. In total, we did more than 7,000 camera trapping days as part of the study, found a really incredible diversity of species. I'm not gonna belabor the point, but when we did something called occupancy modeling, we found that there's really no explanation for why some species show up in some places and not others. You know, it didn't matter how old the forest was, it didn't matter how much basal area the forest had. None of the variables that we could throw at the data seemed to suggest that there was much of a pattern about why different species showed up where. Which is, on the one hand, frustrating as a scientist to not be able to tease out those details. But on the other hand, it's kind of really hopeful. It doesn't matter if the forest is young. It doesn't matter if it's covered in mostly wind dispersed species. A lot of these animals will still show up. Case in point about why this is so hopeful is the bear tapir. It's the largest native animal in Mesoamerica. It's classified by the IUCN Red List as an endangered species with a declining population size globally. We had 62 tapir camera trapping events over the course of our study. And of those, 60 of them occurred. We found 60 of the 62 events were in young or intermediate age forests, and only two of them were in the old growth forest. And it was quintuple the per trap night incidence rate once we controlled for the fact that we had fewer camp trapping nights in the old growth forest. But that's pretty incredible and very hopeful, I think, for the value of this regenerating forest for the native biodiversity, and the value that these fragments can provide. If there's still even just a little bit of habitat holding on, it can be incredibly valuable for the recovery of the forest, even if you're using this less intensive process of just relying on the ecosystem to recover on its own. Okay, so the second lesson, and I'm gonna go through the rest of these much faster, but the second lesson that I think we can draw from Kintsugi in thinking about how we can improve restoration comes from this idea that we need to recognize the preciousness of the external inputs that we're putting the system on. Kintsugi is literally using powdered gold or other precious metals in this lacquer that it's using to hold these fragments together. And so to illustrate this, I want to again jump back to Costa Rica and again jump back to this picture that I showed you, because I was actually being a little tricky with it. So I used this to tee up this study that we did on trying to explain the heterogeneity of the recovery of this forest. But actually none of the variables that we looked at explains the difference between these two photos, because they do have the same fire history. They have the same, the same number of nuclear trees in the 80s. They have the same topography, landscape composition. The real factor explaining the difference between these two photos was the soil conditions. There's a serpentine soil underlying the area in the photo on the left, and a more fertile soil type underlying the area on the right that recovered so well. And the reason we didn't look at it in our study is that we didn't want to step on the toes of some of our collaborators. But still, it begs this question, if something like soil conditions or other factors are preventing you from relying on this passive process, relying completely on these fragments to, put themselves together, is there still something that you can do that to more efficiently with, sort of a minimum amount of precious inputs, turn the photo on the left into the photo on the right? And again, can thank Dan and Winnie for providing a great example of how you can successfully do this. And so this story involves them in the 1990s, noticing that there is a new neighbor to the area of the Conservación Guanacaste along their northern border. It was this orange juice company that was just beginning processing fruit for their juicing factory. Dan and Winnie approached this company and found out that they were spending a lot of money processing the waste from these orange peels in accordance with Costa Rican law. And in fact, we're planning on spending millions of dollars on a new waste processing facility. Dan and Winnie smelled an opportunity, and it had the aroma of rotting oranges. And so they figured that of the 230,000 species of organisms in the area of the Conservación Guanacaste, probably at least one of them would happily eat some orange peels. So they would talk to this company and they convinced them to try this little experiment with them. They wanted to put out a whole bunch of these orange peels in a very degraded part of the park. They wanted to see two things. They wanted to see, is there something that'll come out and eat these orange peels and process this waste for free? And two, is this process gonna be damaging in any way to the ecosystem? And so in early 1996, they convinced the company to dump 100 of these dump truck loads of orange peels in this very degraded, slow to recover part of the park. 6 months later, this is what it looked like. Sure enough, some little fruit fly had come out of the forest. In fact, it was this species, but also at least three others. And they had done the lion's share of the work of turning those orange peels into this soup of rich organic material. And a year later, they went back and found that the second answer to their question was also a big thumbs up. It didn't seem like they had done any harm to this ecosystem by allowing orange peels to be processed there. And so they signed this groundbreaking contract with the orange juice company. So in exchange for the park processing the waste for a 20-year time period, the company would donate a whole bunch of land that they owned that still was covered in native forests and that was located along the existing border of the Ecological and Guanacaste. In the first year of the contract, they brought out 1,000 dump truck loads of orange peels and dumped them in this super degraded corner of this old ranch that had been recently incorporated into the park. It was 12,000 metric tons of orange peels. 6 months later, sure enough, it degraded just fine. And this should have been the beginning of a really happy win-win story, but unfortunately it was too good to be true. The company had a very jealous rival in Costa Rica, and they sued on the grounds that their rival had defiled a national park. And somehow they won. And so the contract was voided. In fact, some of the ACG staff were nearly thrown in jail. I'm not going to comment on this, but you can probably guess my feelings about that decision. But you know, lost in the discussion of this lawsuit was what happened to ecologically. And you know, Dan and Winnie tracked the system enough to see that in the areas of this park, in the areas of the ranch where they dumped the orange peels, there's this incredibly rich array of woody vegetation, trees and things coming back. And in the control areas where they hadn't dumped the orange peels, it still looked about the same, still looked like this pasture. So I went in the early years of my dissertation, went back to, and found this site, and it still looked about the same. Where they hadn't dropped orange peels, but where they had put the orange peels, there's this incredibly, incredibly rich regenerating forest that was well on its way to being a fully recovered forest. And I worked with an undergraduate from Princeton who did helped with a lot of this work, John Choi. Brought a drone, and you can see that the top side of the single track red dirt road is where they dropped the orange peels. That's a 12 meter tall canopy there. And below that line, just a few meters away, it still looks like a pasture. That's, you can see bare rocks in there and a lot of invasive grass. Fortunately, a photo can't suffice for a dissertation chapter. So we did vegetation surveys, these transects, we took soil samples and basically found exactly that everything confirmed our eye test. There's triple the number of tree species. There's way more even distribution of tree species. The canopy had closed much better. And when we looked at the soil nutrients, basically everything that plants crave went up. And it was one of the most remarkable clear-cut set of results that I've ever looked at. And you know, it was a one-off study, and actually we had trouble publishing it because of that. And you know, that does beg the question, you know, would this have worked elsewhere? And so we got some media coverage from the study, and we ended up getting photos like this from friends, collaborators, or just random people on the internet that, you know, this is a piles of orange peels being left to rot in Ghana. Other organic waste might be useful too, could achieve similar results. So a lot of coffee cherries, like the fruit around, the flesh around coffee beans, is often not really utilized much, just left to rot. The husks from pressed oil palms maybe could be used in a similar way. You can think of other organic waste that might be useful. And despite this, when we looked, we couldn't find a single example of another unprocessed agricultural or non-agricultural nutrient-rich waste being used to speed forest recovery. Keyword there being unprocessed. People do use compost and things like that, but you know, if we really want to scale this up, if we want it to be truly win-win-win, it's got to be done in a very cheap way. And I just think it's a shame that there's, we have all these nutrient-rich degraded lands and all these nutrient-depleted degraded lands and nutrient-rich waste streams. And just quickly going through these last two points. So the third is I think it's really important that we accept that what we restore or what we get back at the end of our process of ecological kintsugi or ecological restoration might not be the same as what we had originally. I think, it's really liberating to be able to think that maybe instead of going back to state A, that maybe we can celebrate a process that takes us to state D or E instead. And I think that's at the heart of a project that I'm working on now in Madagascar, where we're looking at ways to address a whole bunch of different problems faced by communities. And a key part of that is through agroforestry, so multi-strata mixed species agroforestry in particular. We think there's evidence on the ground already to show that this is a way of dramatically alleviating the extreme poverty in rural parts of Madagascar while increasing dietary diversity and also providing important ecosystem services by restoring at least some facsimile of a forest that can store carbon, stabilize soils, provide clean water and many other benefits. One of which we actually think is keeping people healthy by reducing the risk of malaria. This is something that we're very excited to look at more, which is that maybe these forests or these forest analogs could either harbor bats or be made to harbor bats that then go out and eat the mosquitoes that spread malaria. And there's a lot of moving parts in this project that I won't get into, but we can be happy to talk about later. But it all sort of revolves around this idea that maybe what we get out at the end of the day is not exactly this native forest, but something that we can still celebrate. And then the last point I think that comes from thinking with a Kintsugi mindset is the importance of being creative. I don't really have an example here, but I just want to point out that once you are willing to accept that you might not get back this pristine condition that you had to begin with, and also that that all you really care about is addressing the conditions that are preventing the ecosystem from recovering on its own, it opens up this incredible world of possible tools that we can think about as ecological kintsugi, but maybe can't be counted as restoration in a more strict sense. So, you know, some of those examples I've talked about already, agroforestry, orange peels maybe. But we can also think maybe about women's education or alternative livelihoods or building healthcare infrastructure as ways of addressing the underlying drivers that are preventing an ecosystem, even a very diverse, complicated tropical dry forest from recovering on its own or any kind of forest. And just to close, I want to come back full circle because I didn't really complete the story that I started with. That area that burned down in Indonesia, this is what it looks like as of a couple years ago. The NGO that I was working with, they went back, they were undeterred, they replanted the area that had burned, and now it's formed a closed canopy. It's shading out these fire propagating grasses and ferns, and it's well on its way to becoming a diverse forest. And I don't want to undercut the importance of doing ecological restoration, even in this very traditional sense, because it can have amazing results and can be really important and should be a priority in a lot of circumstances. Case in point, the same group expanded, had so much success when they reforested the other area, and they expanded to another site and were able to build a new biological corridor to better link to endangered orangutan populations. And they had incredible success with that too. And it's ironic that I use this organization, Alam Sehat Lestari, and their American counterpart, Health and Harmony, as an example of sort of this traditional restoration, ecological restoration thinking, because they're in fact one of the best examples I can think of for ecological kintsugi. They focus on healthcare. They literally are saving the forest with a stethoscope. And in fact, to bring it even more full circle, this is a group that we are working with on our project in Madagascar. Through sheer coincidence, they were starting up operations around the same time as us. And our vision so aligned with what we wanted to what we hope to achieve there, that we partnered with them and are working closely with them down there. I'd like to thank the funders that made my dissertation research possible, collaborators that it wouldn't have happened without, and all the collaborators that I'm working with now, and funders for our ongoing work in Madagascar. And so with that, I think I've gone over time a little bit, and I would love to talk, answer any questions you have.
That was a great presentation. I think I really appreciate you not only showing data, but also putting it in the context of this bigger question about how to do restoration. So before we go into Q&A, I just want to remind the attendees to use the Q&A box to submit all of your questions. And I just want to start off with a question of my own. I was really curious about why using orange peels besides the idea that they were just available. Was there a study about their chemical composition or why they would be better for restoration compared to other organic waste? And I think you mentioned that a little bit, but I'm not sure if I understood the rationale behind it.
Thanks, Aura. Yeah, that's a great question. So if you talk to Dan and Winnie, Dan, he was purely opportunistic about it. He just thought anything would work. There really wasn't a literature on this, especially at the time. He said that if he had been working in another part of Costa Rica, it would have been coffee cherries or it would have been sugarcane husks or it would have been something else. He also thinks that it's probably more important that it suppressed the invasive grasses than that it provided, soil amendments or things like that, provide this nutrient input. It turns out that it probably is one of the best things that you could try and do this with. And there's reasons to believe that it might work better than a lot of these other things. And I don't want to say that, I talked about agricultural or other wastes being potentially useful. This isn't free license for people to dump whatever they want on degraded lands. We published a follow-up kind of commentary, a bit more of an editorial on our more data-bearing paper. And we outline the steps that we think interested parties should look into, including doing very careful small-scale trials, looking for potential contaminants, doing the hard legwork to make sure that that success could be replicated with other organic materials. Did I answer your question?
Yes, thank you. So looking at the questions, there's a question from Christina. She says, Tim, you are specifically addressing large-scale restoration efforts. Have you read or are you familiar with Talami's work on a homegrown national park? The idea is that individual landowners or homeowners can make a difference. What is your opinion on this model of trying to recover area around homes, expanding and recreating nucleus points of native biodiversity versus these large-scale restoration efforts?
I think it's incredibly important and really empowering to try and make the difference where you can. We should all be thinking globally, acting locally. I think there's no reason to not simultaneously pursue bottom-up and top-down approaches. I think both can be really important. Just the way that my brain works, I tend to look at these things from a 30,000 foot view, and it's from the macroscopic perspective. I do worry that just there's only so much land, and if you're not trying to pursue these large scale goals, it's going to be really hard to meet all of our needs simultaneously to address the specific needs of biodiversity in different areas while also generating jobs, income, and food that we need to sustain ourselves. And so I think, yeah, both are really important. I happen to just have looked more at these bigger scale approaches and opportunities in my own research. But yeah, both are super important.
Thank you. That's a great answer. I have a question from Natalia Aristizabal. She says, great talk, Tim. I was wondering if you all looked at connectivity in the landscape or what are these fragments adjacent to as potential variables to explain presence of species, more thinking about the vertebrate pictures that you showed.
We didn't look at connectivity per se. We tried to look, keep an eye out for autocorrelation in our data. That's connectivity in a sense, maybe. I totally skipped over the methods of that section, but there we had three different variables we looked at for landscape composition that we thought might be important in sort of a connectivity sense. There's this very extensive GIS process where we took these old images from these aerial images of the whole park from the 80s that were probably taken by like a CIA spying operation. It's not actually clear where these pictures came from. That's a whole other story. The ACG was involved in the Iran-Contra affair, but I digress. What we were able to do with that is actually map out exactly where the old growth forest was. Then we use these different metrics for all our camera trapping sites of like how close you were to the old growth forest, and then what percentage of your surrounding area was old growth forest, because we thought those things might be really important for determining like whether you're going to have these old growth forest dependent species showing up in a site. And basically none of those variables really popped up in our models for individual species as important. Maybe that's a problem of not enough data, but there's only so many camera trapping nights you can do it for a dissertation chapter, I guess. I wouldn't be surprised if you could tease out some of these connectivity questions or habitat condition variables as being important for some species. We weren't able to do it at least in the study that we put together. But that's a really good question. Yeah, obviously connectivity is super important. And is a really good, a really important factor to think about in applying these ideas.
Yeah, that would be an interesting addition, because a lot of these species, especially the tapir, I mean, they probably would find their resting space in the old growth, but go out in the day. And then that might explain a lot of the vertebrates that you're seeing.
I mean, certainly the tapirs wouldn't be around in the system. Like, they don't like the branches. So they wouldn't be present in the system if there weren't these fragments to begin with. I think my theory with the tapirs is other people have found that they like secondary forest. My theory is that they're low to the ground, but they're browsing. They're not just eating ground cover things. So I think maybe having a young forest where there's a lot of, especially a lot of pioneer species that maybe have less well-defended leaves, I think there's just more for them to eat in the second growth stuff. Night and day, they just love secondary forest. Probably more so during the day. I think you might be right about that, but I'd have to actually go back and look at our data again.
Thank you. Well, I have another question from Taylor Ricketts. He says, do you think the successes from Área de Conservación Guanacaste are replicable? And how much of the success is due to the, it says unicorn, but I'm assuming it's unique nature of Dan and Winnie? We need people like that everywhere before we can have widespread success?
If I were gonna channel Dan and Winnie for a second, I've heard him answer this question before. And I mean, as incredible as those two are, and they truly are, some of the most impressive scientists I've ever had the privilege of working with. I think we need people like that as the Wright brothers, as the first people to like build a plane and try it out and fly it. But I think now that that model is established, now that these ideas are out there, now that people know that you really can just restore an entire lost tropical forest, that paradigm has shifted. Now I don't think you need people. I think you need impressive people, but I think impressive people are everywhere that you look. Something that I've heard Dan say multiple times is, will this model replicate elsewhere? Like Costa Rica is maybe just this really special place, like, no standing army, this total commitment top to bottom in society to to conservation. But, you know, like the Wright brothers didn't, what Dan says is, you know, the Wright brothers picked a sunny, calm day in the rolling hills of North Carolina to test out the, you know, their first plane. They did not pick like a stormy winter day in Chicago, windy winter day in Chicago. But that doesn't mean that we can't fly planes now in almost any condition you can imagine. I think so long as we're willing to build on that success and see it as a model and see, you know, stand on the shoulder of giants, I think the passion and the interest and like similarly impressive people exist everywhere to replicate this in all sorts of settings.
Thank you, Tim. So before I ask, I have a question of my own that I want to ask, but I want to remind people to ask your questions in the Q&A box. We still have about 5 minutes. And so I have a question. You talked about ecological kintsugi versus ecological restoration. And I was wondering if there really is a distinction between those two, and do we need to kind of define this new terminology for what you're proposing?
So glad you asked that question. Yeah, this is something that I've wrestled with myself. I wrote a draft of like a perspective piece on this. And that was the comment that my advisor had on it is, you know, is do we really need to, can we just expand the definition of restoration? And I think, you know, despite that comment, I do think that it's useful and important to have this separate term. Because, you know, there's a lot of overlap, and I do want to recognize that, you know, when I tried to brainstorm all the things I could think of for the perspective piece that would be restoration or maybe rewilding, it would be only ecological kintsugi. There's a whole bunch of things that I came up with that really probably just, you know, fall into both categories. And so, you know, maybe what if we just, so the question is, what if we just expanded the idea of restoration to include these other things? And I think it's valuable to have distinct terms even when you have overlapping concepts. One way to think about this is like, you know, think about Congress. Like there's, you know, we have Republicans and Democrats, and they actually vote together on quite a number of bills, like even in these incredibly polarized times, like, you know, something like a quarter or even half the time, any given Republican is voting at the, you know, the same way as any given Democrat on a particular bill. And yet nobody would confuse the two in our current society. Like I think you can have, you know, different poles within the same broad area that can be useful concepts to distinguish between. And for me, what it comes down to is those slides that I showed early on. And I think it's important to have restoration, ecological restoration, as this concept of pursuing a particular baseline condition. Because that is, you know, that is something kind of distinct from being willing to pursue these, you know, not necessarily the pristine condition, but, you know, whatever is stable now and delivers the valuable ecosystem services that we want and that we're looking for. I really do think that, you know, it's important to think about have a term for going from B back to A, no matter what. That can be really important. Sometimes we just, no matter how difficult it is, we want to rebuild that biological corridor and not just accept some other ecosystem state that delivers some but not all of the original ecosystem services from that condition. You know, you can think of the value of mangroves, for example. You want mangroves specifically along a coastline because they're is so important for mitigating storm surge and things like that, and for serving as a nursery for important important fish species and other marine species. So I think it's important to have a term for something like this, where it's hell or high water, we're getting back to state A. But then I think it is really very different to, even just to say like, let's do the minimum possible to get the ball rolling so that we can spread our resources further. I think that's a distinct idea. And I think even, some people might call this ecological restoration also, but especially this case, I think we need a term for this situation where we're willing to try and get to D and E rather than A, because we know that A is not coming back, or at least it's not coming back in any reasonable amount of effort, but that we can really do a whole lot of good by trying to get a degraded ecosystem back to a D or E kind of state. So that I think are the two reasons why it's important to have a distinct term, and why it really is a distinct term from ecological restoration.
Thank you. That clarifies it for me. Thank you very much. We only have a minute, so I'm just going to read one more question that we have from the attendees. Tom Hudspeth asks, Have you seen the PBS show The Age of Nature? Examples, reef off Belize, peatlands in Borneo, old forests in Poland, planting trees for carbon sequestration and other ecosystem services. It claims, and this is in quote, restoring nature may be the best hope for fighting climate change and slowing down global warming. Do you agree with this?
That is a great question. I haven't seen the PBS show. I would like to. I think there's no silver bullet, first of all. I think no matter what, we're going to have to take a number of different simultaneous avenues to addressing climate change. I think ecological restoration, even in sort of the strict traditional sense, is a really valuable one and should be pursued and should be scaled up. But I think, this idea of ecological kintsugi is also a really, really valuable one. And, they, in part because they deliver so many other co-benefits in addition to just storing carbon, particularly dealing with biodiversity. The reason we can't focus on restoration exclusively, though, is twofold. One is that there's just not enough land and ocean to, unless we get really weird with it, to be able to fully address the climate crisis through those solutions alone. You're gonna have to address emissions and do mitigation, reduce emissions in the first place. Especially since once we restore those ecosystems, a lot of them slow down the rate at which they're storing additional carbon once they hit some sort of stable equilibrium point. So there is this question of scale, and there's this question of the needs of addressing the damage that we're doing in the first place. There's only so much land that we can restore that prevents it from being sort of a pure silver bullet solution. But yeah, I absolutely think that this is low-hanging fruit for sure. We should be doing to restore these ecosystems, turning degraded ecosystems into these productive agroforests or productive silvopastures, or just bringing them back to some ecological state that's healthier than in the degraded state, because of all those co-benefits that it generates.
Thank you, Tim. We're gonna have to wrap up. I'm sorry we went a little bit over. Thank you so much for your presentation and for answering those questions. It was wonderful to have you here at the Gund Exchange today. On behalf of the Gund Institute, I want to thank Tim and everyone who has joined us online today. The video and podcast of today's talk will be available next week on our website. And please join us again next Friday, November 6th, for our next Gund Exchange with Lizzie Kral from State University of New York at Cortland, whose talk is entitled The Hidden Architecture of Economic Order. Talk to you all then. Have a great weekend.